I've talked about the upsides of pharmacologically boosting GLP-1 activity in terms of weight loss, given the ravages of obesity, and I've also discussed its downsides, including common gastrointestinal reactions and muscle loss, as well as the rarer and more speculative side effects such as thyroid cancer, pancreatitis, and pancreatic cancer. And I've summarized the cost-benefit trade-off, detailing for whom the benefits may far outweigh the risks, at least in the short term. But is there any way to get the benefits of GLP-1 without the risks, by boosting it naturally with diet and lifestyle changes? Well, there's exercise appears to acutely increase GLP-1. There have been 5 studies of exercise in GLP-1, and 4 out of 5 of them found higher concentrations of total GLP-1 after high-intensity interval training and sprint interval training, as well as moderate-intensity continuous training, with no apparent difference between high-intensity interval and moderate-intensity continuous. Compared to control groups where the study subjects didn't exercise at all, both types of physical activity, high-intensity interval and moderate-intensity continuous, induced significantly higher GLP-1 concentrations immediately after exercise and 30 to 90 minutes later. Unfortunately, there appeared to be publication bias, meaning some trials that failed to show an effect may have been quietly shelved, thereby skewing the results. But what's the downside of exercising? The evidence is overwhelming that nearly everyone can benefit from becoming more physically active. What about diet? There are a variety of natural products, foods, beverages, and spices that have been shown to boost our own natural GLP-1 levels. But can endogenous GLP-1, meaning GLP-1 from inside the body, work as an alternative to the drugs that mimic GLP-1, like Ozempic? If you haven't yet, I recommend watching or rewatching my video about what GLP-1 is and how it works to best fully grasp the issue at hand. Our natural GLP-1 levels rise and fall in response to meal ingestion. When we take these drugs, though, levels in our blood remain relatively constant and high. But high here is a bit of an understatement. The total concentration of these GLP-1 lookalike drugs in our bloodstream is typically around 20 to 30 nanomoles per liter. Okay, here's how much GLP-1 rises naturally in our bloodstream in the 2 hours after we eat a meal, up to maybe 20 or 30. Picomoles. Nano means billionth. Pico means trillionth. So at this scale, drug levels are up to like 25,000. How could boosting natural levels even come close? Well, part of the discrepancy may be an artifact of taking blood from people's veins to do blood tests. Since natural GLP-1 is rapidly deactivated by an enzyme in our blood, by the time GLP-1 is secreted by our gut, makes it through our liver, heart, and lungs, then out into our arteries, only to later reach the veins where the lab tech is pulling out the blood, the levels we see are lower than the arterial levels that GLP-1 receptors are exposed to throughout our body, though only by a relatively small amount. But how do drugs like Ozempic sit around the body for weeks instead of minutes? They're chemically modified to stick to the most abundant protein in our blood. So even though the total drug level in our blood is up in the nanomolar range, it's so tightly bound to protein that the active level in our blood that's free to actually interact with tissue receptors is like 100 times smaller, at least down in the picomolar range. Thus, although at first glance it appears that plasma drug levels are extremely high, they actually may be closer to those of natural GLP-1 levels after strong stimulation. But still, there seems to be a huge discrepancy. It's GLP-1 activation in the brain that appears to account for the regulation of food intake, but it isn't currently clear how this might be related to GLP-1 in the blood. The primary source of GLP-1 secretion in the body is the gut, so wouldn't it get eaten up by enzymes in the blood before much of it even made it into the brain? It can cross the blood-brain barrier, but is enough really getting up there? Well, GLP-1 is also produced by nerves in the brainstem itself, and a large body of evidence points to the appetite-reducing effects of GLP-1 mimicking drugs like Ozempic being mediated by these brain GLP-1 receptors. So how could natural blood levels, expected after dietary interventions aiming to increase the secretion of gut GLP-1, still have clinically relevant effects? Yes, the GLP-1 released from our intestinal cells is rapidly degraded, leading to low systemic levels, but its effects appear to be mediated by vagus nerve stimulation. The vagus nerve, connects the gut straight up into the brainstem, so it's directly wired to the brain and doesn't have to rely on blood transport. But wait, there are GLP-1 receptors on the pancreas, the kidneys, the liver, the heart. Why would the body have GLP-1 receptors on our peripheral organs if the hormone acts mainly through the vagus nerve? It's possible that strong stimuli can boost levels high enough in the blood to activate these peripheral receptors. So perhaps the way GLP-1 normally works is that we eat a meal, and GLP-1 sends the appetite-reducing signal to our brain directly through the vagus nerve, and then our brain relays the messages to the relevant systems throughout the body. Injecting people with high levels of a GLP-1 mimicking drug like Ozempic means it can circulate directly through the bloodstream to all these organs, including the brain, and a strong dietary GLP-1 stimulus might be able to do both. But you can't really know whether natural physiological levels of GLP-1 can suppress appetite until you put it to the test. When different levels of GLP-1 are dripped straight into people's veins, you can see a dose-dependent reduction in both hunger and food intake. Okay, but effective doses used in infusion studies quadrupled baseline levels or more, whereas the blood levels increased by GLP-1 boosting foods tended to only double baseline levels. So while high-dose GLP-1 infusion drives a clear change in hunger and eating behaviors, is it possible that inducing GLP-1 secretion through diet may not? Well, remember how food naturally only boosts blood levels up around 20? It turns out you can get a significant drop in food intake, up to 30 to 35% less of an all-you-can-eat meal, simply by getting your GLP-1 levels up to 10 or 15, or even just 5. That is well within doable dietary ranges. So while low natural levels might appear to have little effect at first glance, a slight increase in levels by dietary manipulation of GLP-1 secretion could be sufficient to have clinical relevance. Thus, we don't have to strive for levels comparable to those obtained using drugs. And of course, this makes sense, right? I mean, why would our body naturally produce an appetite-suppressing hormone in response to food if it didn't end up suppressing our appetite?